Welcome everyone to the Self-Sabotage Cure Summit. I'm really excited to introduce to you Esther de Saint-Germain. Sorry, I probably messed that up a little bit. She is a wonderfully weird woman. That is her brand. She has a book called The Wonderfully Weird Woman's Manual, and she's a branding expert, as you can see from her background. She's worked with corporate clients, and now she coaches small business owners and helps them. And she has kindly given us a freebie called Freedom Joy Mini Creativity Course, which I highly recommend that you join and learn about what she's doing to bring out your authentic self. She's all about authenticity and sharing your personal message and your zone of genius. She has been a perfectionist for most of her life, and today she's going to share with us how that's affected her and what she's learned might help us. So welcome, and thank you so much for coming.
Thank you for the wonderful introduction.
Thanks. So tell us, Esther, when did you find out you were a perfectionist?
I actually thought, so I had this misconception about what it meant to be a perfectionist. I really thought that perfectionism was about doing something really perfect, like excellence or something. And it's not about that at all. So what I did was I ran away from art school in my fourth year. really very timely. And because I was so, everything was so easy at art school. So what I did was, I loved to read. So I was reading all the time and I was studying, and I loved to do little, I tried out things, and I had this huge stack of books, and then I had to deliver something, and I just said, I just grabbed a stack of papers, and then I wrote something on all those papers, and then that was my assignment. And then they were all like, wow. And I felt like such a huge, huge fraud, because it was way too easy. And I thought being an artist was all about having these huge struggles and having a really difficult and hard time. And so when I was in my fourth year, I was at a big art store. An art bookstore, and I had all these huge books about Picasso and Louise Bourgeois and Rembrandt, and I just stood there in front of this in front of all the bookshelves, and I watched the backs, the covers of the books, and I thought, there will never ever in the whole history of humankind be a book about Esther, the most important artist in the entire world. And at that moment, I decided to quit art, and I wanted to be an artist more than anything since I was like 2 or 3 or 4 or whatever. I really, really wanted to be an artist. But I decided at that moment that it was just not for me. And that I would never be unique and special and amazing whatever. And so I quit. And I think I said something like, I need to do more with books and studying and because everybody bought it. They thought it was a really good idea, even though I was doing okay, actually, at art school. So I became an art historian, and then art became like something for the artist, and talking about art, discussing art, promoting the arts. That was what I did. So I never even, and I loved being an art historian, and I loved studying art history, and I loved every second of it. And I never touched art again.
Wow.
So I only touched art when I opened, like, so when I had a big exhibition and I had curated the exhibition and I needed to open the crates and study the art and help hanging it, that then I touched art. And I once went into the art supply store and I bought a little sketchbook and a pen and a little, because I boxed all my art, so there were no art supplies
anymore.
Everything was gone. And so I once bought art supplies, and then I sketched something, and I thought, oh, it still looks exactly the same like I did at art school, so nothing has happened. Mm-hmm. And I threw it away.
Wow.
Yeah.
Feelings of fraud.
Yeah.
Completely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then I was all brainy and then I had this, I was partner in a big consultancy firm. And one day I just walked out because I felt really, really, really horrible. And well, it's a long story, but it ended me walking out of this really, we had a big villa. Mm-hmm. And I felt so horrible because there was no place for any form of creativity there. And I went home and it was dark and I opened the door of my home office and I sort of cried out, what is the purpose? What am I doing here? And so I sat down, and at that moment, and it still gives me chills, it felt really like there was some sort of a presence there. Mm-hmm. Who picked up, and I picked up pens in different colors and I started to draw, and it just happened. And I thought, okay, something is happening here. And I had drawn creative fire with flames and everything. And at that moment, I just realized that what felt like the ice cold claws of perfectionism. And imposter syndrome, like, you won't believe how bad. Yeah. And for 27 years.
Wow.
I know.
Yeah, it's amazing when you hear these stories from different people about, and I mean, you know, I'm just looking at you and the background and how you could say you're not unique, right? I mean, you're so unique, and it just like shines through you. So this is really a problem for people, all people, I think, but especially in the online business. Yeah. Or when we're trying to find what our calling or our passion is, and we, like you said, sometimes you think it's too easy. There must be something wrong. Yeah. Like it can't possibly be, you know, I must be doing it wrong and that everyone's going to find out. And yeah, so you learn to get through that and to be your authentic self. So tell us a little bit about how you got past this perfectionism after you did that drawing and opened your eyes.
What I did was I started creating like immediately. Okay. But so what I did was accepting. I just accepted that I was I still accept that I'm a perfectionist.
Yes.
And the more I see it like clearly, the easier it is, and it will never go away. It's like imposter syndrome. It will never go away. It will always be there. But I immediately see it. So what I do is I create and just like whatever, like little drawings or whatever. And when I while drawing, it comes and it goes. It's like there is this huge... it's like a surge of self-criticism, because it's basically it's complete lack of self-love.
Yeah.
And so self-love and surrender and joy and breathing cannot live in the same place as perfectionism. So what I do is I draw, and then this surge of something goes wrong. Don't do this. You're spoiling the art. And then I just breathe and I accept. And then I keep going. So it's like meditation.
Yeah.
So this is what I do in daily, in like little self-help things.
I love that, Esther, because I think this, very similar things happened to me. Like I was always fighting with myself, and it was always the struggle. And then when you can accept and just say, oh, here I go again, oh, there's that voice in my head, you know, and I think it, for me, it also made a huge difference, the acceptance of, you know, this is how I am, and you're right, and it's not going away. But once you kind of accept it, so I love that, and I love how you've brought that kind of meditation into your daily life to help yourself, obviously moving forward and doing lots of great things. So tell us why a little bit about failure and why you think failure is such an amazing thing.
Failure is so good.
Yeah. So, why is that?
Well, imagine there wasn't something. So I've been working in design and branding for a very long time, and in design thinking, failure is like it's like the queen of everything. It's you cannot create a car or a computer or whatever without making failure after failure after failure, because it's only the it's like there's this point where something fails and then you have to fix that and go in a different direction. Mm-hmm. And imagine that someone would create a car and just said some it's like, oh well, I'm afraid to make I won't test it because it might fail. I just sell the car like this and I'm not going to test it because, oh, what happens when it would fail? Well, then people would die. Wow. So failure is, and it's Seth Godin said something like the marketing guru, he said, I'm more successful than other people because I fail more often.
Wow. Yeah.
And so a failure is never, it's never an end. You see what it is and then you accept that it has failed. Wow. And then you fix what failed.
Right.
And then you move on.
You grow. Yeah. Amazing. Yeah. I think, I think a lot of us watching have a fear of failure, right? And that often stops us in our tracks. But you're so right; it is something to help us grow and learn and I've heard I think Michael Jordan as well saying, you know, he don't see the billion shots he missed, only the ones that he got because he kept practicing or whatever. Yeah,
so. It's all fear.
Yeah, fear.
So fear lives in the future. It's not in the now.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
And so, and it happens all the time. Like, I have to share a program that's really dear to my heart, and I'm actually procrastinating like crazy because I'm afraid it will be rejected.
Yeah.
But I don't know because I haven't shown it to anyone.
Yeah, and it's so personal, right? And yeah. I think when we're like with our online, really, it feels like it's a rejection of me, not yeah. even not my program.
Yeah,
yeah. So it feels scary. So tell us a little bit more. I know you're really passionate about the arts, and as you described before. So do you think that everybody should do some kind of art? Is yeah. it helpful for even people that can't draw yeah. a stick figure yeah. like me?
Yeah. So this is the whole creativity thing. People think some people are creative and other people are not creative. And that's complete and utter bullshit. So it's like there's this line, and some people are evolutionary creatives and other people are revolutionary creative. And the majority is somewhere in the middle. They're both, they know how to do evolutionary things and revolutionary things. So the evolutionary people are, these are the people who finish things, and they're really, they know the little things. Like my husband is complete evolutionary person. So he checks my text at double spaces.
Right, yeah.
I just don't see that.
Right.
Or I just start something and then I don't want to finish it, and then so he can finish it.
Yeah.
And that's a special sort of creativity. But people think that it's only the revolutionary, like
yeah.
artists or designers or architects or whatever, people who create really wild things. And so, but that's just a different sort of creativity. And so we need to honor our own personal unique creativity, and everybody needs to create something. And you don't have to go to the art while you can, but you don't have to get your own studio and do wild things. You can also make like little notes and like little scribbles and or cook something that you've never cooked before, or set the table and make it in your own work of art. Or when you know what I love to do? I became a mother when I was 42 and I married when I was 41. So being a mother and a wife still feels like this very awesome, yeah. amazing thing to me. And I can, when it's dry and I can, what do you, hang the laundry?
Yes, and, yeah. Hang the laundry on the line.
Yeah. I make a work of art out of that.
Oh, wow.
And I really like, and I love doing that. It's like, okay, I'm going to do this there, and then the little, what's the
pink? Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And then, so a red one and a wooden one. And so I like to make a work of art out of hanging the laundry.
Wow.
It's like little things like that.
Yeah, I really like that because it's... sometimes we think of things like that as chores, right? Setting the table, hang, but if you can kind of bring that creativity into it and see it in a different way, I think it'll make us think different thoughts, which is what we want, right? Yeah. So I know you've had a whole journey from being this art student to where you are now. So tell us a bit about how you stepped out of your kind of comfort zone to become the personal branding queen, and why you think our viewers should also step out of their comfort zone.
I believe that everyone has this unique brilliance.
Yeah.
And especially the ones who are beating themselves hardest with feeling like an imposter or perfectionist.
Yeah.
These very often I find are the ones who basically can do anything if they really set their mind to it. And it's not the ones, it's very often the smart, very special people who are hit by imposter syndrome. It's like Meryl Streep, who still goes, she is sort of, she has this imposter syndrome. And the idea that you're not special, beautiful, amazing enough, it's like such a, it's not true.
Yeah, I actually read this morning, you know, Michelle Obama's book has come out, and she actually said, I still get imposter syndrome. I think, why is everyone listening to me? They're going to find out I actually don't know what I'm talking about.
So. Yeah. And so, and then the fear comes like, oh, but they will find out. They will find out and they're going to hate me. And so this is all, this is just accepting that it's like that. And that the moment where something is really, really, comes really, really easy, it's like when you're in your zone of genius. So it's like when it's stinking easy, that's where your zone of genius is. It's also where the money is.
Right. Yeah.
Because so
in a way, because we think
yeah. So my zone of genius is I can sit opposite someone or not even opposite someone, and I immediately know this is your unique brilliance. This is what you need to do. This is where these are your soul clients, and these are the steps. And it's so easy. It's not even fun anymore.
Right.
That's hard. I found that really, really hard to share that. And so I'm a soul whisperer. I mean, I whisper with souls, and I was really, really ashamed about that.
Right.
And because I'm this intellectual person.
Yeah.
And I thought I cannot be both this intellectual and this soulful, spiritual, woo-woo kind of person. But you can be whatever you want, actually.
Yeah.
And so after, the thing I feared the most was people from my high school, that I would say on Facebook, I'm a soul whisperer, and then they would write a comment with, you're not a soul whisperer, you're just a stupid girl, or something. And it's like, so after sharing that I am a soul whisperer, it was really easy for me to crown myself personal branding queen.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
I actually really, really, really feel that everyone should crown themselves queen of something.
Right.
Or king of something.
Yeah, that's a great idea. And I love that after you kind of got over that hurdle of what other people are going to think of me and what people that my family and people that have known me all my life are going to think when I suddenly say I'm doing this thing. That's a huge thing for a lot of us. So you said after you did that, then things just started to flow kind of more easily. So so really good advice.
We love it when someone says, I'm an expert in this or that.
Yes.
No one else will tell you that you are the expert. This is about claiming that you are that expert.
Right. Yeah. And that is hard to do. You see other people, you compare yourself.
Yes.
But I think what you do, what you said, is you find that really targeted thing that's your genius and only you, because of your experiences and personality and everything, you know, you grab that and claim it. I love that. I'm going to be, have to think, well, I'll be queen of something. I will let you know next week.
I actually got crowns everywhere, and I just crown, and it's really fun. It's really fun to get yourself some little tiara or something. Crown yourself.
Oh, you actually crown yourself. Okay, I'm gonna do that. That sounds like fun.
It's really fun, and this is the other thing. Perfectionism and imposter syndrome cannot exist when it's being made fun of.
Right.
So yeah. Laughter and humor and having fun, sort of, it dissolves perfectionism.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. You change the emotion behind it. Don't
yeah.
You?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So Esther, you talk a bit about we all have a muse and how we can listen to this muse. And so tell us a little bit about that and what you mean by that.
I believe that we all have a muse. So and it's very often and it's much more fun to think that you've got a muse, yes, and to imagine that there is some sort of, I don't know, an entity, spirit, ghost, a person out there who helps you to make decisions, both in your business, but also when you create something, like when you're stuck, especially when you're stuck in perfectionism, that there is someone there who sort of pushes you, like, for instance, when you're out of inspiration and you have no idea where to go next. So imagine you're creating an online program and then you're stuck because you think, everything has been said already and I don't know where to go next. What you can do is just go really quiet and imagine that there is someone either here, this side of your shoulder or the other side, who is sort of pushing you or tapping you on the shoulder, like, hey, look at this or look at that. And it's like you're opening it, you get out of your head and into your heart, and you set yourself up for serendipity, for seeing things that you didn't see before.
Right.
Because there are clues around us all the time. It's like little things like, oh, there is this little magazine over there and it's been there like four
you never noticed.
Weeks, and you never noticed it, and then you open it and all of a sudden, ta-da, there is your answer. And your muse is someone or something, whatever it is, that can help you. But it's so you need to sort of surrender to the calling of it and to the fact that it wants you to be happy and to succeed. And sometimes when I do this with my clients, it's like parents or grandmothers or sisters or whatever. And either people who passed on or people who are still alive, and then they're there and they help them. Or it's like a teacher who was really important to you.
I love that. That's like, that is so cool. I love all your, I think you do things in a very playful way, and that, you know, people like me that do things like, well, I'm not very playful, I would say. So I find this very exciting to think about, you know, being more creative and letting myself be more creative, yes, and doing things like crowning yourself or having this muse. That's such a good idea. Somebody that you can listen to another voice.
Yeah.
Actually your voice, isn't it? But yeah, that's that's a great idea, Esther. I love that. So just before we end today, so your book is Wonderfully Weird Women's Manual. So tell us, where did this wonderfully weird term come from, and what does it what does it mean?
So I researched my clients because I wanted to know who my soul client is. So it's, some people call it ideal client or client avatar, and I call it a soul client because I want to work with people like on a soul connection. And so I did the research, and then I found out that the clients I've been working with since like forever, in all different sort of capacities, and that are really connected with, were women who are very sensitive, very multi-passionate, and fiercely bright.
Right. Wow.
I had this conversation with a client, and she said, I just don't want to feel weird all the time.
Right.
And I always feel the odd one out. I'm always alone, and I don't want to feel that anymore. I don't want to feel weird. I want to feel wonderful. And then we sort of said, wonderfully weird. And this stuck, and it's like this whole wonderfully weird movement with wonderfully weird t-shirts and buttons and the book and the academy. And so these are all women, and I know there are a lot of men who feel connected to this as well, who very often felt like they were the odd one out, like I don't belong anywhere. And then they all come together, and so it's really, really important also for people who are not wonderfully weird that you are with people who get you.
Yeah.
And it's so important that you connect to these people and find your tribe.
Yeah.
Or set up your own tribe. If your tribe doesn't exist, then you need, because the thing is that we think we're the only one, and then we're not.
Right. Yeah. I love that, and I love and I think, you know, probably the thing that people think is weird and is holding them back is actually what's going to be theirs. Yeah. Success, right? That's what's gonna,
it's exactly what will make them known and famous and wealthy, and yeah. But it's like we've been told for so long that we're weird, or that we're not fitting in, or and being trying to being pushed into a box, and then the moment you open that up and you decide that this weirdness is your uniqueness. That it's the moment where everything changes.
I love that. Well, thank you so much, Esther, for joining us today and sharing some really fun, playful, practical things that we can do to get over that perfectionism, that imposter syndrome, and move us forward in life and in business. And we'll have the link here to Esther's website, to her free course, and also to her book. So you can check out all the information about her and learn more about her if you click the speaker link below. So thanks again, Esther, for sharing.
Thank you very much for having me.
Thanks.